This is a very special treat, actually. I call it a treat because we hadn't originally planned for it. But you know how the universe works. And we've got this fabulous person, speaker, and now author amongst us. He's pretty unconventional, as you can see up there on the board. He's won awards for India's Best Stand-Up Comedian and Asia's Best Stand-Up Comedian, Forbes magazine called him the global face of Indian stand-up comedy, and the Harvard Business Review called him one of the most influential comedians around the world. He holds an MBA from the University of Oxford and is often engaged as a motivational speaker and executive coach. Under his happiness project, he performs to support charitable causes across the world. And his new book, for those of you who are joining us and don't know about it, it's outside, available for you to pick up. An autobiography called Naked has been just released. So get yourself a copy and get it signed by him as soon as you can. Without any more delay, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together and welcome onto stage stand-up comedian and author, Bappa CJ.
Thank you so much, Rini. Let me just start by saying it is an absolute honor to be introduced onto stage by Rini, who is not only wonderful, but a friend as well. As a stand-up comedian, I pay a lot of attention to the person who brings me onto stage. Like recently, I was in Singapore, and the show I was doing was hosted by a Pakistani stand-up comedian. So this guy got on stage, he warmed up the audience, and he invited me onto stage. In that second, I realized I had been a part of history. It was the first time I had seen a Pakistani invite an Indian to occupy a piece of land that he was occupying before. Now, I don't know if you've ever been to Singapore, but nothing ever happens in Singapore. The last time I went there, front page of the newspaper, there was a pig on the street. Boss, if there is a pig on the street, in Singapore, it becomes headline news. In Germany, it becomes a sausage. Right? In America, it becomes the president of the United States of America. And then I'll be honest, that Singapore show, we had a very drunken night, finished at 5:30 in the morning. Next morning, I'm catching a flight to Kuala Lumpur. I get to the airport. In my hangover, I lost my boarding pass. I went to the woman at the counter. I said, "I'm sorry, ma'am. I've lost my boarding pass. Can you give me a fresh one?" This woman started shouting at me. "How can you be so careless? How can you lose your boarding pass?" I said, "Excuse me. You work for Malaysian Airlines. You lost an entire plane, all right?" And the thing is, it's quite, I noticed there was politics in the session before this, so I'm going with that flow. You see, when we travel abroad as Indians, sometimes people don't know a lot about us. I met this English fellow. He says, "Oh, you're from India. I know what Indians are like. I've seen Slumdog Millionaire." I said, "That's like me saying, oh, you're English. I know what the English are like because I've seen Mr. Bean." Then I went to America under the Trump administration. I had the mistake of having a beard. I get to immigration, the officer looks at my passport, looks at my beard. He says, "You know what? You Indians, you're a mistake. In fact, India is a mistake." I said, "Come on, officer. As an American, you should be grateful to us." He said, "Why?" I said, "Well, because when Christopher Columbus discovered America, he was looking for India. So to be perfectly honest, you are the mistake." I went to the US, I was doing this big TV show called Last Comic Standing. Has anyone heard of it? Massive reality show, 3,000 contestants. I was representing India. And what I found really amusing was how excited all the American comedians were. "Oh my God, oh my God, 10 million people watch this program. I was like, dude, I come from India. If I open my bathroom window, 10 million people will show up live. Right? And I'll be honest, I'm not a big fan of reality TV. I got caught into it. I don't know if you remember this, Shilpa Shetty had gone to London. There was this program called Big Brother. Big racist thing happened. Now, I was living in London at this point, and people kept asking me, who is an Indian? As an Indian, what do you think? I said, boss, in India, 1 billion people know that Shilpa is going to win, which she did. Because think about it, how do you win that show? Anybody? Voting, exactly. How do you vote? You call in. Who the hell do you think is answering those phone calls? Call centers in Gurgaon. I'd like to vote for Jade, please. Shilpa. I did a show at the embassy. This fellow came up to me afterwards. He said, John Smith, ambassador. I said, Papa CJ, Maruti Esteem. No, don't laugh at that joke. That is a very cheap joke. It can be difficult for us. Even we are quite confusing to other people. I was taking driving lessons in London. This instructor asks me, he says, you Indians, why don't you drive in a straight line? I said, listen, I'm from Calcutta. In England, you drive on the left of the road. In Calcutta, we drive on what is left of the road. Right, ladies and gentlemen, let me start by saying it is absolutely wonderful to be here. But there are two things. There is a good thing and a bad thing. The good thing is that I'm in one of the most wonderful colleges in the country, and you have a 100-year history. Can you give yourselves a round of applause for being a fabulous institution? The bad thing is they have put me straight on after lunch. This is when all of you feel sleepy. So I need your support for 1 minute. Give me a cheer if you will support me for 1 minute. I want everybody to stand up. Everyone's going to stand up for 1 minute. I am going to put on some music and come and dance with Sister Jesvina, and you are going to dance where you are. Let's have some music. You want to keep dancing or what? Okay, so now you have to decide what to do, because I'm a comedian, I'm very lazy, I have done no preparation for this. So ideally what I would like to do is, I would like to have the whole session as a question answer with all of you. Now I've heard before this, it was only the teachers and the slightly elderly people who were asking the questions. So you have two options. Either we can do the whole session as a Q&A, where you ask me questions and we chat, or I can tell you three or four small stories and then we do the Q&A. Yeah. Stories? So you're lazy as well, you don't want to do any work. Okay, so here's the deal. If I tell you five or six stories, will you ask me questions? Yeah. Done. So there are five or six stories that I have heard in my life, which I have learned lessons from. So I wanted to share those stories with you. The first one has to do with the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. You see, many years ago, there was a marketing manager in Calcutta for the Bata Shoe Company. So he got this idea, why don't I send a salesman to the Andaman and Nicobar Islands? You know, let's see what the market is like. So in those days, you had to go by ship. So the salesman got into the ship, takes 3 weeks, gets there. And he goes there and he finds that nobody is wearing any shoes. So he goes to the post office. In those days, you sent those telegrams by Morse code, right? So he sends a message to his manager. He said, listen, nobody here is wearing any shoes. There is no market at all. I'm taking the next ship and I'm coming back. Okay. Now a few years passed and a different marketing manager came. So he also had the same idea, you know, let me find out if there's a market in these Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So there was a new salesman. He sends this fellow. Again, he goes by ship, takes 3 weeks, he gets there. And he sees that nobody is wearing any shoes. He runs to the post office, quickly sends a telegram to his boss, saying, "Boss, I am not leaving here. The market is wide open. Nobody has any shoes. Please send me all the stock that you have." So same situation. Your attitude sometimes shows you the kind of opportunity that exists. Who would you rather be, the first person or the second person? I remember when I moved back to India and started doing stand-up comedy, we didn't really have English language stand-up. I was talking to an auntie and she says, "Beta, tum kya karte ho? What do you do?" I said, "Auntie, I'm a comedian. I tell jokes." She says, "Beta, even I tell jokes." "What do you do for a living?" Right? So at that point, it's very easy to say, listen, there is no market for this, but there are opportunities to create those markets. The second story, in Japan, I think it was the 70s or the 80s, there was a shoe factory. Now, all the workers wanted better conditions, they wanted better pay. So what did they do? They went on strike. But a strike in Japan is very different to a strike in India. These guys did not stop working at all. The only thing they did, they started manufacturing only the left shoe. And they told their bosses, "Until you do not meet our demands, we will not manufacture the right shoe." How beautiful is that? Right? They cannot be accused of lowering productivity. They cannot be accused of not doing their job. And yet they're achieving their goals. So that's an interesting story about work ethic. Now you're thinking this is probably the wrong slide. So here's another story. There was a salesman in this company who was a super salesman. Any market he went to, he used to do very well. And as often happens, you know, his colleagues got quite jealous. So they went and came up with this plot and they went to the boss and said, "Listen, you keep giving this fellow these easy assignments. We want you to give him something harder, you know, because we get all these tough jobs." So he was asked to go to Saudi Arabia and sell bras. Right? Now keep in mind that this is a country where you cannot even see the women, let alone meet them. So he goes there and for a few months he's quite upset. Then about 6 months later, they find out that he has broken all sales records globally. So eventually he's called back and his colleagues go to him and say, "Listen, we want to apologize, right? Because we were jealous of you, but you have proven that you are fantastic. But just tell us, how did you do this?" He said, "You know, I went to this country and the first time I went there, I didn't speak the language, I couldn't speak to the women, I couldn't meet them. So I was sitting one day and thinking to myself, what should I do? Then I noticed that people there pray 5 times a day. And each time they pray, they have to go down on their knees and their knees get bruised." Out of the box thinking. So keep in mind, not everything has the same solution. I don't suggest you do that in college. I see Sister Jasmina is laughing at this one. But you never know what uses things might find. Oh, have we already gone to the next slide? This is another wonderful story. There is a lawyer who is defending his client who is accused of murder. Right? Now he knows his client is guilty. And the judge is about to pronounce the verdict. So as a last minute, he says, "My lord, the person who my client is accused of killing, in the next 1 minute, he is going to walk in through that door." So everyone waits for 1 minute, they look at the door, and after 1 minute, the judge turns around, he says, "My friend, that man did not walk in through the door." The lawyer says, "Yes, my lord, but for that 1 minute, you looked at the door. That is reasonable doubt." The judge goes, thinks about it, and he comes back and he pronounces the man guilty of murder. So the lawyer says, but my lord, you looked at the door. He said, yes, I did. But your client, he did not look at that door. Right? So you're standing in the middle of the, hopefully this will work. Attention to detail. Another thing to keep in mind. Just move to the next slide. Here's another lovely story I like. Many years ago in the Mughal kingdom, there was an emperor. And there was one young fellow who committed a crime. So he was sentenced to death. So this fellow comes in front of the king and he begs and he pleads. He says, you know, Jahan Pana, please just do anything. I will do anything for you. Just give me one more chance. So he says, okay, I have a horse. I will give you 1 year to make this horse fly. So he says, sure, 100% I will do it. So he's released. He goes home, gets to his house, his family is celebrating, he's free. Then he tells them, that, listen, this is what I have agreed to. The king wants me to make his horse fly. Now the family is very upset. They said, you know, if you were sentenced to death, we know you would have died. But here we will be dying every single day, knowing that it is inevitable that you will be sentenced to death. So this is a story about the value of time. He turns around and tells his family, he says, 1 year is a long time. Anything can happen. The king might die, I might die, or the horse might fly. Right? So keep in mind, when you are going through a difficult situation, right, time is a fantastic healer and lots of things can happen over time. This last story, this is a story that comes from my own family. My father used to work for a tea company and he was the head of marketing. Now his job was to try and get as many people as possible, as many shopkeepers, to try and stock his brand of tea called Goodrick Tea. Now what did he do? You know, nowadays it's fashionable to use the word hustle in business. Oh, I'm a hustler. He employed an army of housewives. There were 50 housewives whose job was every day to keep going to different shops and asking them, Goodrick ki chai hai? Do you have Goodrick tea? The second the shopkeeper says, I don't have it, why don't you take Tata tea? Why don't you? No. When you have Goodrick, then we will come. Imagine this. This kept going on for a month. Random women kept coming and asking for this tea. 1 month later, my father's salesman went to this shop and said, would you like to stock Goodrick tea? What do you think happened? Right? So these are 6 stories that I wanted to share with you. And now it is your turn to do some work. So raise your hands if you have a question and we'll do a fun Q&A. Any question about anything at all? And Sister Jasmina has already danced for us, so now you know there are no boundaries as to what we can do today. Any questions? Come on, let's get a hand up. We'll get a microphone to you. Anybody at all? Yeah, there's somebody. Put your hand, just stand up wherever you are so they can get a mic to you. Stand. Stand up, tell us your name and tell us what your question is.
Hello, sir. I think you're really fun. Thank you for being here.
My
pleasure. I wanted to know why you called Papa CJ.
Why am I called Papa CJ? That is, firstly, the answer is in my book. And even though it says naked on the cover, I promise you it's a clean book, okay? It's not as naughty as the cover looks. And that photograph is from a live show, but it's not such a... See, I started doing stand-up comedy in London. Please have a seat. I started doing stand-up comedy in London. And when I started doing stand-up, I was the only Indian comedian in the entire UK. I did 700 shows in 3 years. And I always wanted to represent India in a very positive light. I wanted to show my country in a very good light. And I've been called CJ since I was 16. And the reason I added the Papa was, I think subconsciously, I was thinking to myself that Angrezon ko bhi lagna chahiye, unka koi baap hai. Right? So that is one of the things I wanted to get across, so which is why I kind of stuck that name. There wasn't a lot of thinking behind it. Yeah. Any more? We've got a hand up somewhere else.
Hi.
Where are you?
So you're a comedy veteran, right? So what do you think about the present Indian stand-up scene? And where do you see it going?
You know, the beauty about stand-up comedy is that there is no straight path.
Right.
You can do stand-up, you can do sketch, you can do improv. And it is such a broad range of what you can do. And I think that a lot of the future in Indian stand-up will be in regional comedy. You know, initially when we start, we have this attitude of, I was answering an interview today, and they were asked, the question was that, you know, when do you think Indian comedians will achieve success on a global stage? And my answer to that is, why is the global stage a measurement criteria, right? I did not leave the corporate world to join a creative field and be in a rat race in the creative field. You know, I think when you define success, and this is a very important definition in terms of achieving happiness, very often we grow up in societies where success is defined for us. Somebody else is saying, you know, finish school, finish college, get an advanced degree, get married, have two children, then you are settled, right? Why does that have to be the definition of success? If you look at our fairy tales, right from the time you are children, why does the princess have to be rescued by the prince, right? Why are we teaching them all these things right from the start? So I think it is very important for you to define what success is for you. Because if you chase somebody else's definition of success, you may be sitting in a fancy car and a big house, but you will always be unhappy. So I think with the Indian stand-up scene as well, as it evolves, you know, I keep saying that comedy or any art form is an outward expression of an inward journey. The journey has to be inwards. You know, we are privileged to perform in fields that have no rules, no boundaries, no social norms, no guidelines. So you're forced to ask yourself what you think. I remember the first time I went abroad to study, and the teacher asked me the question. He says, you know, so this is the question, what do you think? And I said, what do you mean, what do I think? I have grown up my whole life with my teachers telling me that these are the right answers. This is the answer. If you answer that, then you are correct. So I think it's very important for us to look inwards and shape our own journeys to find a model of happiness that works for us and is individual to us. And it is my wish that that should happen for the Indian comedy scene as well. Yeah. Anybody else? Yeah. There's somebody upstairs as well. There's a boy. Oh my God, do boys also get a chance to speak here? Don't worry, since you're in the minority, we'll get to you as well with the microphone. But yeah.
Hello.
Where are you? Where? Oh. Just stand up so I can see you. Yeah. And tell me your name. Yeah.
Yeah, my name is Dhara.
Dhara.
Your Wikipedia page reads that you're in a...
Slowly. None of these speakers are pointing towards me. Give me some more, huh?
Yeah, the Wikipedia page reads that you're a laughter yoga instructor.
Yeah.
So what do you do different from what you do in stand-up comedy?
You know, actually, I had two options in this session. One was either to do a Q&A or to do laughter yoga. But I only have half an hour, so I can teach you the whole thing. But what we will do is this. Before we end the session, I will do some laughter yoga with you guys. One of the things that I do is something called that I call the Papa CJ Happiness Project. So I do free shows in hospitals. I go to people's hospital rooms. I go to their houses where people have been sick for a long time. And I perform for them, just for two people, five people, seven people. And I found that laughter yoga is an incredibly powerful tool. Because even after I leave, I can teach them this and they can practice laughter on their own. So they don't need me to be around. But we will do that just before we finish, whenever they tell me I've got 3-4 minutes left. Yeah. Gentleman in the front. There was that guy upstairs, yeah. So I'll come back to you. Let's
check.
There's a young fellow upstairs. Just. He's been standing for a very long time. So we'll go to the gentleman at the top because he's got the cheap seats in the balcony. So first you, and then you, and then we'll come to you, sir. Yeah.
Right.
Just stand up, man.
Hi, good afternoon, sir. So my question to you is, how do you carve a niche for yourself in such a different field? I mean, you had the guts to break off from, you know, the relative norms and venture out into something like stand-up comedy and carve a niche for yourself there.
Okay.
So what would be your advice to someone who's looking to, you know, break out into a different field of the same?
Okay. Okay, thanks for that question. Two different parts. One, I was able to carve a niche for myself in the UK because I had a unique voice. I was the only Indian comedian And I was talking about things that other people were not talking about. When I came to India, I had a bit of an advantage. Again, there were only two people who were doing stand-up comedy at that time. So it was easier to get a name for yourself. But I think eventually what happens, and this comes to the last question, you know, initially when we start as comedians, you want the confidence that you can make everyone laugh. So you'll go for the easy joke. So the kind of joke I would do is that, you know, as someone who lives in Delhi, I don't understand the language in Bombay. You know, we call it bread, they call it pav. We call it pyaz, they call it kanda. We call it a servant quarter, they call it a 2 BHK. Right? So first you go for the easy joke, then you'll do observational comedy, then you want to be seen as an edgy comedian, right? So you'll do politics, you'll pick on positions of authority, you'll use bad language. But after the first few times you've said those bad words, the shock wears off, right? You have to be funny after that. But eventually the journey is inwards. You talk about the things that matter to you, that are unique to you. And you almost don't care what the audience thinks. Your audience will find you. The people who don't like what you're doing will automatically weed themselves out. So if you think of a Russell Peters, Chris Rock, George Carlin, they will not change what they're doing just because you are in the room. They have their value system and their point of view. So I think if you want to be, to carve a niche for yourself, what is a niche? It is something unique. You have to be unique, right? If you're trying to do business, you can only be a second best Steve Jobs, but you can be the best you. So you got to figure out who that you is and be the best at that and hope as hell that people will enjoy that person. So that's the answer to that. Gentleman at the back there, yeah.
Hi, my name is Neil. My question is, who's your stand-up, who's your favorite stand-up comedian except yourself and why?
Okay, so I'm not my favorite stand-up comedian. My favorite stand-up comedian is a gentleman by the name of George Carlin. He did stand-up comedy for over 50 years, and I think he was almost more philosopher than he was comedian. And if you haven't seen some of his videos, you must see it. He's absolutely fantastic. I mean, today we're all very conscious of the climate and the environment. One of his most wonderful pieces is that is about the environment. He says, you know, I can't stand all these people who are saying, oh, save the whales, save the dolphins. And it's so arrogant to say, save the planet. He says, boss, the planet is not going anywhere. We are. Right? Think of his point of view. You're not saving the planet. The planet will be here long after you have gone. But it's interesting to see the kind of thinking he puts behind his comedy. So George Carlin is my answer to your question. Yes, sir. Also, somebody let me know on timing, huh?
I believe many have, I think we've got a couple of questions that came up, which does relate to what I'm going to ask you. So this environment that you created just now has actually made everybody happy. I think everybody agrees with me. How do you create such an environment, yeah, given the fact that we are in situations which are very serious, and we're talking matters that are probably, you're dealing with short-tempered people. And people from diverse,
Okay, I've understood the gist of your question. So at the end of the day, we are all human beings and we all want to be happy, right? I genuinely believe that, you know, people often talk about people getting offended with stand-up comedy. I genuinely believe if people understand your persona and your intent, I strongly believe in karma, whether it is business, whether it is stand-up. If I get on stage and you in the audience sitting there can feel that I am here to bring you joy and I want to make you happy, right? With no filters, even if you don't agree with the joke or don't like my point of view, you will sense my energy. And I think that is something that can spread. So there will always be stuff going on in the world. There will always be negativity. But if you can be a source of positivity and spread that, people will be drawn to you. I think it was Tom Peters who said that you are the average of the 5 people you surround yourself with the most. Surround yourself with positive people. Nobody wants to be around somebody who's miserable. Okay, am I almost out of time? Because then I'll do that laughter yoga thing that I promised you. I'm almost out of time.
Yeah, 1 minute. See, no, what, just here. Yeah. What inspired to make you be a stand-up comedian? What's your qualification, and do you think it's a natural ability or a God-given gift? Oh, you've developed it.
That's not one question, ma'am. That's many, many questions.
It's all connected, sorry.
What inspired me to do stand-up comedy was I saw somebody doing it. Uh-huh. And I thought it's the most amazing thing in the world. I mean, here's a guy on stage with a microphone in his hand, and he's just having fun. Look at what I've done in the last half an hour. I have laughed with people, I have danced with Sister Jasmina, and I'm just chatting with you guys and having fun. This is my job.
That's what? What made
When I
you?
Walk into my office, people clap. Have you seen that happen in any other office? So that's the short answer to your question, because I know we're running out of time. Okay. You asked the last question? Sure, go ahead. Now you're getting warmed up when I'm running out of time.
No, I was waiting to get the last one. Maybe that gets a clap.
Oh, you like to have the last word. You're that kind of person.
Okay, so tell me, what is more difficult, cracking a joke or being butt of a joke? And have you experienced this yourself, being a butt of a joke? Like, a joke has been played on you, and how did you react? Did you laugh or did you get offended?
Ma'am, I am an Indian man. My life is a joke. Right?
I got what I wanted.
So cracking a joke is sometimes the harder thing to do. Okay, so laughter yoga. I'll give you a fast forward to laughter yoga. Basically, what laughter yoga is we start off with laughter as an exercise, and through playfulness and childlike behavior and eye contact, that laughter actually becomes real laughter. Now, your body cannot differentiate between real laughter and fake laughter. You still get the same benefits. Now, with a joke, I'll crack a joke, you laugh, then you'll stop laughing. It's left to chance. With laughter yoga, we don't leave it to chance, we're laughing continuously. So, take 15 seconds and tell the person next to you on a scale of 1 to 10 what your energy level is like. Quickly, quickly, quickly. Tell the person next to you. Okay, stop. I should have actually done this at the start of my session, because I realized I've already brought the energy level up. Okay, now what we're going to do is this. Everyone stand up for a second. You're going to look at the person next to you. You're going to tell them your name, tell them where you're from, and you're going to laugh. So, for example, if I'm talking to Maddie, I'm going to say, "Hi, my name is CJ. I'm from Delhi." Go, do that now. Tell each other. Okay, stop. One more exercise. Don't sit down, Mighty, get up. Don't sit down. Now, you're having a fight with the person next to you. This is called argument laughter. You're going to look at them and go, come on, look at them. Okay, stop. One last thing. I need somebody with a watch over here. Just come here for a second. You got a watch? Do you think it is easy to laugh? Yes? Okay. Now I'm going to show you how laughter can be an exercise. I have a challenge for you. You got a stopwatch on that? Or just time it. I have a challenge for you. I want you to laugh for 1 minute. Non-stop. But this is how you do it. 1 second. It's called gradient laughter. So you will start by laughing softly. Have you understood? Wait. When you do this, I want you to make eye contact with the people around you and point at them and have fun, okay? You have 1 minute. Your time starts now. Go. Look at each other, laugh. Only 20 seconds so far, keep going. Come on, 20 seconds more, keep laughing. Ten seconds more.
5 seconds. All right, stop. Give yourselves a round of applause. Have a seat. Sit down, sit down. What is your energy level on a scale of 1 to 10? Has it gone up? Are you tired a little bit? Anyway, guys, I have run out of time. If you want my books, I'll be outside. I'll sign them for you later. My name is Papa CJ. God bless you all. Thank you for having me here. Cheers, guys. Thank you. Thank you.